In this webcast, we'll be discussing another type of electron sink, specifically the sigma star orbital as our electron sink. And the interaction we'll be spending most of this webcast discussing is that of the end of sigma star donation, or a non-bonding electron pair or lone pair donating through a pi-type interaction into a sigma star orbital. Now, how can we recognize the generic form of this type of interaction? It's shown here, where we have a lone pair on some atom designated as Y, donating in, forming a double bond between our Y and our carbon, and kicking off some leaving group, X. Now, this X and Y can be oxygen, nitrogen, fluorine, sulfur, or chlorine, and in one particular case, X can sometimes be H. We'll get to that in just a quick second here. But discuss the general form first. Here's an example. We can recognize this form. We have our Y, our C, and our X. So we can take lone pair on oxygen, come down, make a double bond between our oxygen and our carbon, kick off our fluorine. So we've made, once again, a double bond, no bond resonance form. Our positions of our nuclei did not change. They're in the exact same places they were before. But the electron configuration of our molecule has changed. So therefore, this is a valid resonance form, our double bond, no bond form. If we want to look at the specific orbitals that are involved, it's down here below. Now keep in mind that our carbon-fluorine bond has a sigma bonding form and a sigma star antibonding form. Now there are two electrons in that bonding orbital down below, and the antibonding orbital is vacant. Now the bonding orbital is mostly located directly between the carbon and the fluorine, right between them, and the sigma star orbital has these giant lobes on the outside, look like big Dumbo ears there, out on the outside of our nuclei, and that's where electrons can add in to that sigma star orbital. So if we were to look at a Newman projection of this molecule here, this is the gauche conformation. We're going to draw a sawhorse projection of this gauche conformation. We have our donation from our lone pair on oxygen donating into a sigma star on our CF bond. So we're going to draw our sigma star orbital, shown here. Once again, our lobes are on the outsides, on the backsides away from our carbon-fluorine bond there. We're going to do our shading. There is opposite shading right in the middle there. So therefore, our blues on the outside, we have this very good pi-type overlap here on the backside between our blue lone pair on oxygen and then the backside giant blue lobe from our sigma star orbital. There is our good overlap there. And only this gauche conformation can maximize this N to sigma star overlap. Whereas this gauche conformation sterically is not as favorable as the anti-conformation. However, this extra energetic stabilization that occurs from this N to sigma star overlap makes this gauche projection, this gauche conformation, much more stable. Now, this biological example, one I told you to get to later, is this NADH, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide hydride. It's our biological source of hydride in the body. Now, we can recognize this generic form here, shown in red. Once again, we have our Y with our lone pair, nitrogen. We have our C to our X. In this case, hydrogen is going to be our leaving group, kicking off a hydride. So, lone pair comes off our nitrogen, cascades down, and kicks off an H minus. Now, one of the things you may remember is kicking off an H minus is very energetically disfavored. But it's much more favorable in this case by looking at the orbital overlap in our NADH. Now, if we look at the sigma star orbital, that's the orbital we would be breaking here, the sigma star orbital from our CH. It's aligned very well with the P orbitals in the rest of that ring. So we're shading our orbitals here. We have very good overlap between the sigma star lobe on the bottom there and then the P orbitals in the rest of that ring. Now, if you want to see another example, you can check out the anomeric effect in Bruce chapter 22, section 14. So throughout most of these webcasts and the previous webcasts, we've been showing resonance forms. We've been showing alternative electron configurations for a molecule, but where the positions of the nuclei don't change. And for that, we use this double-headed arrow. This arrow from our resonance has two heads on it going in both directions. Now, when we do a typical reaction mechanism, we're only going to be moving forward. When we change our electron configuration, just like resonance, but the positions of the nuclei change as well. And in that case, we only have this single-headed arrow going only in the forward direction. Now, looking at an example here, look once again at our NADH. We have our electrons starting on the nitrogen, cascading down, and kicking off our H minus. But notice this H minus has not moved. It stayed in the same place. Therefore, this is a resonance form, and is the reason why we have this double-headed arrow. Nuclei, same place, electron configuration changed. Now, if we were to involve this in a reaction mechanism here, where we have our electrons cascading down off our nitrogen and kicking off an H minus, but now that H minus is actually adding into, say, a carbonyl, and therefore that H has changed positions. This H here has moved, and also this H on the ring has also moved. It's relaxed into its more sterically favored position on that pyridinium ring. So the nuclear positions have changed, and electron configurations change as well, which is why we use a single-headed arrow for this reaction mechanism. We use that single-headed arrow there. So this is just a little refresher about which arrows to use when you're drawing your mechanisms.